a couple of weeks ago in Scottish Sport when we featured him against Aberdeen, and he's obviously another player. Like a lot of the Kilmarnock players are having good seasons, and he pushes forward. Obviously, depends who they're playing against, but you don't often come against up against many wingers, and Gus McPherson seems to be the type that sits back and does the defending.
Against Kilmarnock. Now, Rangers made one change from the team which defeated Celtic on New Year's Day. David Robertson coming back after Stephen Presley failed a late fitness test. Killy boss Tommy Burns left himself out of the side, bringing in Mark Roberts, who scored when Killy beat Rangers at Ibrox, and that was, of course, back in August. The referee was Les Marstrom from Forth, summariser Gordon McQueen, match commentator Jerry McNee.
So away we go for the first big match here at Ibrox in 1994. When I say that, in the knowledge there were 20,000 here the other day for an Old Firm reserve game, with around 45,000 in the stadium this afternoon, just about the same as we're here when Kilmarnock won by 2-1 back in August. And Kilmarnock very positive that day, and threatening to do so here as well, but a little bit of a miscue there by Ali Mitchell, and the ball drifts out of play for the throw to Rangers. David Robertson back after his injury. It's aimed at Hatley, who's been very much the player of the season so far for Rangers. Robertson's header. Long one away by Brown. And a bit of a stumble there by Andy Milne. It's picked up though by Craney. It's challenged by McCall. It breaks to Trevor Stephen. Good play by Stephen, picking out Alexei Mikhailichenko. And he has to settle for the throw-in after the challenge from Gus McPherson, who began his career here at Ibrox. Good challenge that by Black. This is Shernick skimming. That's Craney, leaving it to Black. Stringing the passes together, it's Mick Skimming sending it through and headed behind there by Robertson. Well, Ali Mitchell was coming in behind him, and the Rangers defender did the wise thing and sent the ball behind for the corner. So a positive enough start by Kilmarnock, and it's Mark Riley going out to take it, and there's Mark Roberts, who scored here in the last match between the teams. High one played in, and Goff's up there for Rangers, and as far as Montgomery. This is Black, who have a crack there, and knocked away by Goff. Header from Trevor Stephen, not a very good one, and that's not a bad effort going in from Ali Mitchell.
Well, they've certainly adapted a positive attitude to the start of this game. Kilmarnock stringing a few crosses together, and eventually fell that one to Ali Mitchell in a long-range effort. It wasn't that far off the mark.
Danny Craney, getting it off to Black. Craney again, skimming, calling for it. Goff reads the situation up. Ball still in play. It's Gary Stevens for Rangers. Given away though, to Black, and the home crowd not too happy at the moment with Rangers play. This is Jury, he needs some help here. It's not forthcoming, but he gets the free kick. Danny Craney in there. But Jury surrounded by Kilmarnock players. This is Robertson. And looking for Hatley. And Hatley pushed there from behind. Andy Milne, the culprit. And a real chance here for Rangers now. So many players who can shrink the ball so well, so Bobby Geddes with a lot to do. So Heathley's there, so too is Jury, and it's Jury who strikes it. It's deflected and just past the post. Rangers have the corner, well struck by Gordon Jury, almost bringing him his fourth goal of the season.
Yeah, it was a dangerous place to give a free kick away, particularly the way Gordon Jury strikes the ball, but the Kilmarnock defence stood its ground there and is deflected for a corner kick.
So Jury in there at the near post as Trevor Stephen prepares to take this one for Rangers. Goff's up there challenging! And inches away from the Rangers skipper.
It's It's a really high floated corner kick. Terrific leap here from Richard Goff, but just sends that one past the post.
Little touch by Jury, but picked up by Montgomery. Given away though. This is Jury. Mikhailichenko's on the far side. That's a good ball, despite Ali Mitchell getting a touch to it. Still, it's Mikhailichenko looking for Hatley. At the offside flag, could get up on the far side. And the Rangers fans unhappy.
Well, it was a terrific ball in the first place from Jury out to Mikhailichenko. Then Mikhailichenko made a run forward and probably should have pushed that one in the path of Jury, who'd made a good run up to support him on the right-hand side.
So, Tom Brown. A challenge going in there from McCall. That's out for the throw to Rangers. McCall leaving it to Robertson. A fair bit of length into these throws. It's aimed at Hatley. Picked up by Mikhailichenko. Robertson. Jury. Hatley. Trevor Stephen. Black's in there for Kilmarnock though. It's Mark Riley getting it clear, but only as far as McCall. This is Gary Stevens. Looking for Trevor Stephen. A mistake there by Black. And amazingly, Kilmarnock survive. Well, there's a claim for handball there by Trevor Stephen. But as the ball was played through, Black didn't seem to realise there was a Rangers player running in behind him in the shape of Trevor Stephen. And I just wonder if the goalkeeper got a touch in that one. Certainly Trevor Stephen was claiming there was a touch.
Yeah, it was just a bit of an up and under here from Gary Stevens and Tom Black. I'm not quite sure whether they thought Bobby Geddes was coming out to collect this one, but he was a bit hesitant nevertheless.
To Mikhailichenko, first time ball to Hatley. Stabbed through there nicely by Hatley. This is Murray, he's surrounded by Kilmarnock players. Finds Robertson, he's closed down by Craney. Still very little space there, and that's out for the throw to Rangers. Mikhailichenko trying to keep that ball in play, but it still goes Rangers' way. Long throw from Robertson, looking for Hatley. This is Jury. Trevor Stephen. Hatley. And he spotted Gary Stevens. And the ball's behind for the goal kick. Well, that was great awareness. Gary Stevens had been free on the right-hand side. And Hatley picked him out.
Yeah, it was a lovely bit of vision there by Mark Hatley. Everything was very tight in and around the edge of the 18-yard box, but not the greatest of efforts from Gary Stevens.
So a fair bit of movement there, eventually it's to Brown. Pearson playing it through, Goff gets a touch. McCall and Brown there, sixes and sevens, and eventually the Rangers get it clear. That's a good solid challenge there by Gary Stevens. But Goff and Jury losing out. Kilmarnock sling away here, it's a free kick against Gary Stevens. Kilmarnock. Get on with it quickly. This is Black sending in the cross. It's John Brown though, getting the touch from Rangers. Here comes Mikhailichenko. The referee says play on. He was challenged there by Mark Roberts. The ball broke for him. This is Gordon Jury. Still it's Jury, getting away from Milne. Montgomery's across there with him. Still it's Jury to Trevor Stephen. Jury again. This is a good play by Rangers. It's McCall. Looking for Hatley. Well, he got the touch, but no power in the header. Hatley with 21 goals so far this season, a tremendous scoring rate in just 31 games. That includes six doubles. Ball coming off the head of Murray. There's Goff. It's made by Andy Milne. Tom Brown to chase, but Gary Stevens has a bit of time. This is Goff to Brown. Robertson's wide. Mikhailichenko's ahead of him. Robertson deciding to cut inside, and he's caught there by Mark Roberts. It's Mikhailichenko stepping in, and he wins a throw-in off Roberts. So Robertson, despite that foot fracture, going well into these challenges. He's obviously made a very good recovery indeed. practising for the past three games since the defeat here by Dundee United. I'm sure the Rangers fans are delighted to see him back this afternoon. And here's other full-back Gary Stevens, caught there almost by Craney. This is Trevor Stephen, and it's McSkimming skimming back, providing the cover. Sending the ball high out of play for the throw to Rangers.
Commander really do make it difficult for teams, because when they get they've got Tom Brown playing the lone striker's role, and when the ball does break forward, it gets good support, but also in defensive situations they get everybody behind the ball, which makes it difficult for teams to break down.
There's Robertson playing it through, Headley getting a touch, Dury's in there, it's headed away by Montgomery, only as far as Murray. Again, a lot of Kilmarnock players in there, it's Dury with the goalkeeper, and Guinness takes the ball at the second attempt. So, a handshake between Dury and Guinness.
I think in these situations, the referee's always going to favour the goalkeeper here. Bobby Geddes, favourite for that one, and Dury really has no great chance of getting the ball.
Kilmarnock playing with a lot of fire, a lot of spirit, a lot of commitment. That's a nice play by Mitchell. And an apology there from Stuart McCall to the Kilmarnock player. So we're now into injury time in this first half. Owen Valley Maxwell keeping a close eye on things as McPherson takes the free kick. It's headed away by Goff. Only as far as Roberts. Looking for Mitchell. Robertson goes with him. Sliding challenge, and Kilmarnock have the throw. And there goes the half-time whistle. Well, a good first half by Kilmarnock, and I'm sure their fans are the happier set here at Ibrox Stadium. The half-time score, Rangers 0, Kilmarnock 0. So the second half gets underway, and no changes in either lineup. And immediately it's Kilmarnock on the attack, and got the flagging up against Sean McSkimming. Ball played through to him there by Danny Creaney. But McSkimming doing well in the first half, and always a threat on the left side of the field, both on the ground and in the air. Kilmarnock play a lot of high balls into that area for him. So no doubt Killie would be happy to leave here with a point this afternoon, having already taken two from this venue back in August. There's Gary Stevens running into trouble. It's Craney playing it through, looking for Brown. That was a good challenge by Richard Goff. Well, it all began with Gary Stevens running into trouble, and it was Goff to the rescue.
Yeah, Gary Stevens just getting caught in possession here. Craney dinks a nice little ball through to Tom Brown. It was a terrific tackle there by Richard Goff. The danger eventually cleared.
Beautifully beaten there by Montgomery. This is Roberts. Good ball to Danny Craney. Kilmarnock getting players forward now, but Craney completely mishitting that one. And had a few players on the far side of the penalty area, so Craney will be disappointed there. So, Roger Smith again on the telephone. Some instructions. Well, Peter Houser was out warming up a short time ago. I wonder if he's contemplating a change. This is Murray. Galichenko. This is Dury. The referee has stepped in and awarded the free kick. Galichenko. Challenge there. And the referee immediately halting the play. Goff moves forward. Robertson takes a free kick. Dury's in there. This is Headley. Still Rangers pushing forward. It's McCall. Dury. Robertson. Robertson does well. Gets in the cross. Headley's up there. And it's well taken by Guinness. From point blank, Guinness getting down very quickly indeed.
Yeah, the ball coming in from David Robertson, Mark Hatley, And you expect to score so many goals from those situations this year, but never really get the power behind the header. As you can see here, climbs well enough, but no real problem for Bobby Geddes.
And the offside flag has gone up. It's a free kick to Rangers.
You just wonder how long or how much more effort Tom Brown can put into the game, because he's really been asked to do a tremendous amount of work up there on his own for Kilmarnock. He's virtually doing shuttles from one side of the park to the other.
So it's John Brown for Rangers. This is Trevor Stephen getting in behind the defence. It's Hitley, it's off the post, and it's cleared by McPherson. Well, Trevor Stephen got in behind the defence here, drove the ball across, it broke right through to Hitley. He touched it onto the post there, it was McPherson who swept it behind for the corner kick. So that gets the Rangers fans going. And there's a man who really started that, Trevor Stephen sending it in. And the diving header there from John Brown. And eventually Kilmarnock managed to get it clear, and then the ball drifts behind for the goal kick. That John Brown there also coming close, and Rangers will make a substitution. So Alexei Mikhailichenko goes off, the Ukrainian leaves the field, and the Dutchman Peter Hoekstra comes on. And Hoekstra, 5 goals this season in just 12 games, one of them coming against Kilmarnock at Rugby Park in the 2-0 victory there. So Walter Smith and Archie Knox hoping he can repeat that this afternoon. Robertson, he's got Hoekstra to his left, cuts inside up, still it's Robertson, now it's Hoekstra. Playing the long one and looking for Hatley. That's an indication of how difficult Rangers are finding it. It's out for the throw to Kilmarnock. It's Tom Black to Danny Craney. This time it's Rangers' ball. From Gary Stevens, taken down by Hatley, has to play it early, looking for Hoekstra. That's a good ball, it's Peter Hoekstra, he's done it again! Peter Hoekstra, 69 minutes gone. And the man who came on as substitute at Rugby Park and scored a vital goal for Rangers, does it again. Yeah, with a marvellous through ball by Mark Hatley. A little bit of help there from Gus McPherson. We're mentioned just earlier there, trying to get the ball to Hoekstra in one against one situations. As you can see here, that really is a bad defensive mistake. Hoekstra pounces on it and a really good finish. So it's Rangers 1, Kilmarnock 0. Montgomery nips in there ahead of Hatley. Nixon, long clearance, and a miscue there by Robertson. Tom Brown, stepping away from John Brown. Good play this by Brown. Down he goes, claims by the Kilmarnock fans for a penalty, but the referee waving them away. And it's Rangers on the counter-attack. It's John Brown, through for McCall. Hatley's racing through the middle. This is Jury. Gary Stevens is in a lot of space. Jury has a goal. That's a marvellous save by Geddes. It's Hatley. Still it's Hatley. Gets his 22nd goal of the season. It all began with a tremendous shot by Gordon Jury. He had Gary Stevens to his outside, he had the shot, Geddes did well to block it, Hitley came through and knocked the ball into the net.
Yeah, it was a great run forward initially by Stuart McCall. The ball came inside to Gordon Jury, just sat up nicely for him there. He didn't half thump it. Bobby Geddes couldn't hold it, although I'd expected him to hold that one. Mark Hitley waltzes round him.
Rangers 2, Kilmarnock 0. And that all came out of a claim for a penalty at the other end by the Kilmarnock players. John Brown didn't hang about. He bust out of defence to begin the move. And Rangers cashed in. So a smile from Mark Hatley. And no wonder what a season he's having. He carried Rangers through a very difficult spell. and he's well on course to beat his goals tally of last season. I think it was 28 he had, so just six shot of that target. And the way he's playing, he should easily beat it. Rangers really moving up a gear. It's Heatley again. It's another one. It's 3-0. That was a great ball through from Trevor Stephen. So two goals in the space of 2 minutes for Heatley. That one set up brilliantly by Trevor Stephen. Well, they've got the game's over now for Kilmarnock. Their back goal there getting caught a little bit square. Trevor Stephen slides the ball into Heatley's path. And another lovely finish. It's a nice little ball in here from nicely weighted pass from Trevor Stephens. As you can see there, the commander back four caught very square. Just dinks it over Bobby Geddes. Rangers 3, Kilmarnock 0. This is Tom Brown. Trying to switch the play to Craney, but easily cut out by Gary Stevens. Oh, he's trying to pick out Jury. Kilmarnock have it again now. It's Tom Blackwell forward. There's some consolation here for Kilmarnock. Well, Jury runs him all the way through, and that's a goal kick. Good defensive play by Gordon Jury. Running with the Kilmarnock fullback all the way.
Yeah, it's lovely for your defenders when you see your centre forward chasing back like that. Feel it was good defending from Gordon Jury, particularly so late in the game, and he thought his legs might have been a little bit tired because he has put in a lot of effort this afternoon.
A few fans drifting away now, the Rangers fans certainly happy. They've left the stadium on a number of occasions this season in a completely different mood. Here's Black for Kilmarnock. This is Mick Skimming. Harry Stevens in there with him, doing well. Looking for Heatley. Rick's on for Rangers again here. A lot of Kilmarnock players caught forward. This is Hoistra. Heatley's running through the middle. Heatley watching this one all the way, but it was always just too much for him. A good running by the big striker. Hoistra did his best to get it across to him. Trying to pick out Danny Craney. But again, Jury takes up a good position, cuts that one out. And there goes the final whistle. Good solid victory for Rangers. And there's the man of the moment, Mark Heatley, with two superb second half goals. He set up the first one after 69 minutes for the Dutchman, Peter Hoistra. Heatley sending through a superb pass, and Hoistra drilling the ball past Bobby Geddes. Then in 75 minutes, Gordon Jury had a blasted goal. Geddes managed to stop the ball, but Heatley showed his class and walked the ball into the back of the net. And just 2 minutes after that, it was Heatley again. A superb through pass from Trevor Stephen. And there was Heatley to finish off. The final score here at Ibrox Stadium, Rangers 3, Kilmarnock 0.
And close on 45,000 were at Ibrox. There was one yellow card. That was for McSkimming of Killy. After the match, Jerry spoke to Rangers boss Walter Smith.
Our home record hasn't been the best. The crowd were getting a little bit restless at 0-0 going towards the latter stages of the game. And we kept plugging away, hoping that a mistake would come. And I think that was the most pleasing factor, because we didn't have a lot of chances to keep us going. You know, there was no great goal skirmishes, or we didn't particularly look as though we were going to get a goal. And we just kept playing away, and I was pleased in the manner in which we did that.
Is there anything left to say about Mark Heatley?
Well, it's getting more and more difficult each week. He's been left with a great burden this season until we signed Gordon Jury there, who's came on and I think helped him a great deal in recent weeks. But the other players that we played, Ian Durant, they're not out-and-out strikers. And he's been left with the burden of playing and scoring goals, and he's accepted both really well. And his form this season has been fantastic for us.
You said before the match it was a time to show that Rangers were getting back on the rails. Do you think that's now happening?
Well, somebody said he turned the corner, and I said, well, I've said that three or four times this season already, so I'm just hoping that that's the case. It's the first time that we've followed up a good result away from home with another good result at home against a team that I think are very difficult to play against. And I just hope that we can now keep that going throughout the season.
Well, Jerry, I mean, 3-0, it looks a comfortable enough victory, but for 69 minutes, Killie made it difficult, didn't it?
Well, I made the point in commentary yesterday, Jim, that Kilmarnock had managed 7 shutouts in the previous 8 games. I don't think any other team could match that. Mm. Their trademark is that they work very hard for one another. They shut opponents down all day, and as Gordon said during the match as well, the likes of Tom Brown, working defenders all the way, they make it very difficult indeed.
And I've got a good solid back four as well, particularly the two central defenders who I think are very good indeed, Montgomery and Millen. But as you see here, they really work hard for one another. And for me, I think they're about the most competitive side in the Premier League. And great support. I don't think they've set their stall out to defend all the time, because they do get bodies forward in numbers as well. I mean, John Brown and Richard Goff had to put in some good tackles to stop Kilmarnock scoring yesterday. But by and large, they put in an unbelievable amount of effort for one another.
I mean, Burns has done well, hasn't he?
He's done extremely well. And of course, Trevor Stephen was a man who went on to unlock that defence yesterday. He played extremely well.
Well, you're absolutely right, Jerry. The Killie defence, it did take a lot of unlocking. And one of the main men responsible was Trevor Stephen, as Jerry said, who acknowledged that frustration was beginning to creep in.
Come here and done well. I think we've given them opportunities where we haven't done in the past. And as generally, we're all to blame for that. I don't think you can pick on individuals. We've been a bit sloppy as a team defensively. And at times that take our chances up front, you know, at home. But from here on in, we want to eliminate that and make it like it used to be for teams to come to Ibrox. A daunting task to get points here. And hopefully this is the turning point for us.
Some people would say that wasn't your kind of game today, but you kept working away and you unlocked it.
Yeah, it was very tight in midfield, as I say, particularly where I was situated on the field in the first half. There was just a glut of bodies, it seemed. But I had one or two occasions to try and open it up, and I was pleased to help Mark out with his second goal.
A glut of bodies. Gordon, what about Trevor Stephen's performance?
Played well yesterday. Still a player that I prefer in the centre of midfield. I think he's more effective there, but certainly yesterday the middle of the park was a bit of a minefield, because Kilmarnock played 5 players in there, and there was just... there was really no room, and he gave him that little bit of width on the right-hand side, and along with Mark Cahill, who was certainly the outstanding Rangers player, played really well, and a lot of good crosses, unlucky not to score in that situation, and by and large was very effective.
I think the important thing now, Gordon, is getting games behind him. Himself and Gary Stevens have suffered a lot because of injury.
Yeah, Gary Stevens as well, along with Trevor Stevens, I thought looked very sharp as I've seen him in quite some time. Obviously, they both had injury problems, but... as you can see here, Trevor Stephens back to something like his best. Lovely bit of individual skill there.
Work rate, absolutely superb as well.
Well, they're once again getting into the back post, and Mark Haitley's setting up Mark Haitley there. He stabs that one against the post.
Well, you mentioned Haitley, and of course we mentioned him an extra time yesterday. What about this man, Jerry?
Well, that's what, 23 goals now in 32 games, which is superb striking. 7 doubles. And I think he's been kind in Rangers, because if he thunders into hat-tricks, he takes the match ball away with him, so he's helping their finances there. But he really, you know, he's making goals and he's taking them, and great vision there.
Well, actually, Milne and Montgomery handled him pretty well in the first half, and he never really got much joy, but in the second half, like he's been doing all season, he just, well, ran amok, and he's virtually unstoppable just now, he's just rampant.
It's amazing, other managers, you have Lou McCarrie at the start of the programme today, and other managers keep referring to, I wish we had a player like that in our squad. He really is terrific.
Oh, there you are. Yesterday, it wasn't a bad second half performance, was it? He made one and scored two. And good finishing as well.
I mean, what can it be like playing against a guy like that, Gordon?
I'd imagine pretty difficult. But I mean, this has never been really his strength, scoring goals. But I mean, any striker would have been delighted with a finish like that, just lifting that one over Bobby Geddes.
He certainly carried the burden. You know, Ali McCoist has been the hero for years now. And Mark Haitley, I think, has turned it on when it's really mattered this season.
Yes, indeed. And we'll take a short break there, but there's still plenty of action and discussion still to come, starting in a couple of minutes from now with Dundee United against Hearts.
And now, from Specsavers, it's the deal of the decade.
Take the money or choose the deal. Just look.
A free eye test or £10 off. A free second pair or £20 off. A free contact lens trial or £30 off.
I've just spent £70 and got this pair worth £70 free. And remember, that's including your lenses. Take the money or choose the deal.
The deal of the decade at Specsavers. Don't miss it.
New from Ford, another great way to make car buying easier. Escort LX hatchbacks, saloons or estates, all one price. diesels or turbo diesels, 1.4s or responsive 16-valve 1.6s and 1.8s, all one price. That's right, one price. The price of the 5-door 1.4. So without paying a penny more, you can select the body style and engine that suits your needs, not just your wallet. Maximum choice at one price. It's another breakthrough from Ford. For full details, call 0800 111 222 or visit your Ford dealer.
What's going on here?
Oh, hello, boss.
Rosie, a full-strength beer.
But only 72 calories!
But boss can help slimming our weight control only as part of calorie control diet.
Swing your hook!
Lucy, lowering calories, not in alcohol.
Rent it now from Global Video. Four new movie releases for the new year. Why wait a year for satellite when Global offers you a world of blockbusting home entertainment to rent now from our 80 stores throughout Scotland? Plus, special offers include two nights film hire for the price of one, kids' cartoons from 50p for two nights, and a fantastic selection of Nintendo and Sega games to rent. And with even more copies per store, you won't be disappointed. So rent it now from Global Video. Home entertainment guaranteed.
Crest? Yes. But 6 months ago, Jenny had fillings. Couldn't believe it, I felt so guilty. So this time I made sure that she brushed properly and used a good fluoride toothpaste to fight decay. Crest, it really works.
Plaque acids can cause weak spots, but Crest Fluoride System Fluoristat helps put calcium into weak spots to help stop cavities before they start.
Next visit was a completely different story, wasn't it, Jen?
Crest, help stop cavities before they start.
You're not on the scrounge again.
Luke, I just want to borrow your energizers.
You're having a laugh. You know it took me ages to get them back the last time.
Oh, go on.
I know they last longer than ordinary SP batteries, but I do want them back.
I know.
Can I finish, mate?
No, you don't have to go on.
I can afford to go on. I've got energizer batteries.
Energizer. Longer, 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 longer lasting batteries.
Hello again. Let's put the footballing fortunes of the Premier clubs in Dundee and Edinburgh in focus now. Paul and the panel will be taking your calls on 0500 404 000 right after we've seen Hibs against Dundee. But first, Dundee United against Hearts.
There were pre-match celebrations at Tannadice yesterday as United chairman Jim McLean made a presentation to Maurice Malpass to mark his 600 appearances for the club. A tremendous achievement. And the celebrations continued as United struck the target in under 3 minutes. A pass back by Neil Berry seemed to put keeper Nicky Walker under pressure, and his nervous clearance went straight to Scott Crabb, who hit the perfect shot past his former teammate. 1-0 United. Hearts forced United keeper Van de Kamp into action when Scott Leach fired in a shot from 20 yards, but the Dutchman tipped it over for a corner. The game, though, was effectively killed off as a contest in the 15th minute. Hearts' Jim Weir could only head Welsh's ball into the path of Paddy Connolly, 2-0. United were well in command, Hearts were in disarray. Brian Welsh was next to test Walker. Hart screamed for a penalty kick when Leach tumbled as he and Van de Kamp went for the ball, but referee Jim Herald didn't want to know. 2-0 United then at the interval. The second half started quietly. Hart replaced Johnson with Robertson after 8 minutes, but it was United who kept the upper hand. Jim McAnally not far off target here. Hearts then put Mackay on for Berry, and United gave Jerron Nixon his first taste of Premier football when he replaced Paddy Connolly. And he didn't have long to wait for his first touch as United once again swept downfield towards a Hearts goal. McKinley in the end, leaving it for Maurice Malpass, but his shot blocked by Walker. Hearts hadn't given up the fight just yet. Wayne Foster carried the ball to the goal line, and his cross was headed by Welsh across the face of his own goal, but there were no takers. Any lingering hopes the Tynecastle side may have held disappeared in the 75th minute when Malpass crossed for Craig Brewster to prod home goal number three for United. And 3-0 it finished, a shocking result for Hearts, who sit just 1 point off the drop zone. And the Hearts fans directed their anger and frustration towards manager Sandy Clark, who endured a torrent of abuse as he was escorted by stewards back to the dressing room. A 3-0 defeat, a bad day for Hearts and Clark.
It's great to be back in the team. That's the first time I've played for about 3 months from the start anyway. I've been on the bench the last 10 or so games. So it was great to be in the starting 11 and score after 2 minutes. It was great.
And a good performance by Dundee United right through the 90 minutes.
Yeah, I thought the lads played really well. It was a good battling performance, first 10, 20 minutes. We got on top of the game and eventually we ran away clear winners.
Now, I know you spent a lot of your time down at Tynecastle. Does it sadden you to some extent to see Hearts struggling?
Oh yeah. I mean, Hearts are a big club. I think they'll come through it. I think the fans should give Sandy a chance. He's not been manager that long, and I think Sandy will see them through it.
The fastest goal of the day came at Easter Road. The game was just more than 30 seconds old when Joe Tortolano slipped past Stephen Frill on the left, and a good swirling cross met by the head of the smallest man in the park, Kevin McAllister. 1-0 to Hibs, his teammates duly paid homage. But the basement club were desperate to atone, and they enjoyed much of the pressure in the first half. Richie here into the box, but denied by Jim Leighton. Kevin McAllister and Joe Tartolano were always a threat to the visiting defence, this time the former Falkirk star, tormenting Duffy and Dinney, and finding Tartolano, but he was just off the mark. Half an hour gone and Dundee were pressing for the equaliser, and it looked as though it could come. Richie finding Morten Veghorst, but the Dane's angled shot kept out by the post. There were cries of Tortolano for Italy, presumably a local travel agent trying to drum up business for the talented winger. He's inconsistent, but he wasn't yesterday, and his chip here well caught by Mathers, causing problems for the Dundee bench. No shortage of chances at both ends in the first half, and as the interval approached, the Edinburgh men were chasing a second goal. David Farrell here testing Mathers. Dundee's offside trap was well and truly beaten by this 60-yard pass. Tortolano clearing goal, 2-0 for the Highbees. The Dens Parkers looking for offside, but the goal was good. The second half, as you would expect, saw Dundee throw everything at Jim Leighton's goal, but they found their old teammate in top form, here foiling Paul Ritchie. Dundee's good lead-up work fell down in front of goal. Billy Dodds was a constant threat, but Veghorst's finish woeful. Hibs had their moments, Jackson rolling the free kick to Farrell, and he came oh so close. As the shadows lengthened, Dundee's relentless drive for a breakthrough gained momentum. Dodds timing his jump to perfection, but Farrell giving him no chance to hit the target. The long ball had worked for Hibs early in the match, and it almost did the same for Dundee. Veghorst putting Ritchie through in goal, but Leighton again coming to the rescue of Hibs. Another example of the pattern of the second half, Dundee with all the possession, Veghorst and Dodds again linking up on the edge of the box. The shot deflected by Ritchie, but again Jim Leighton in international form. Perhaps the Taysiders' build-up was too predictable, certainly their finishing was poor, and Jim Leighton in top form.
2 points is the most important thing to remove up a place in the league, which is important. And yes, performance is very important for me being a manager. Performance is important, but no, I'm delighted that we've got the 2 points. But okay, the performance wasn't what we wanted.
You're only unlucky when you don't fight for the breaks. And I thought today, we worked really, really hard. And as I said, if it wasn't for a good goalkeeping, Jim Leighton, I think we'd have got something in the game.
So a tale of two cities there. Onto the phone lines now, and the first caller, Johnny Munro from Edinburgh, Hearts fan. Johnny, good evening.
Good evening, panel.
First, I'd like to congratulate ScotSport and ScotSport Extra Time on their new format.
Thanks very much, very kind of you.
No trouble at all. I'm phoning about the situation at Tynecastle at the moment. I think it's quite terrible. It's quite obvious we're desperate. We really need money and new faces. When's anything going to change? I mean, what we really need is a big man up front. I mean, what about you, Rambo? Come on, big man.
Yeah, well, Rambo's suggestion there. You are in training, of course.
That's what Lou McCarty said as well. Edinburgh's too far for me to travel away up there. And anyway, you've got one of my other friends over there already.
What about Hearts, though? What's going to happen? You know Sandy Clark very well.
Yeah, I mean, I sympathise with him a wee bit. We're not the most... if we comment someone, you know, about wanting to start a youth, more of a youth policy, it's, I mean, they've got young players in the team and they're obviously not tolerant enough with those young players when they're starting to shout at Sandy, and he's only been in the job, whatever, since May. So it's a pretty thankless job at the moment for him.
Somebody else in the line, Tom Saunders, also from Edinburgh, and another Jambo. Tom, good evening. What's your point?
Good afternoon, Jim. The question I would like to put to the panel is, why would they think that John Robertson has been left on the bench for so many matches in recent weeks? The lad is obviously fit. He's a senior professional and could probably lend his experience to the youngsters who are playing around him at the moment.
Yeah, he's a top player. Jim Traynor, what do you think? John Robertson.
Well, I think it's the experienced players. They've got to take responsibility, and if Hearts are going to get through this crisis, it has to be them who do it. I think you've got to look pretty deeply here, and if a player like John Robertson, his goal-scoring ability and his stature and his experience is fit, then you've got to ask yourself, is he doing something wrong away from the ground? Does he have problems away from the ground? You never know. It might just be that John Robertson has other things in his mind at the moment.
Do you think he has?
I think there is some sort of problem there, yes.
So you think there's a problem away from
yes.
the football with John?
Yeah.
OK, next caller is John Ramsey from Fife, from Falkland. Hello, John.
Uh-huh. I'd just like to put a point across. Like, I was at Paradise yesterday, and when you go there and see players like, well, John Muller, Wayne Foster, Neil Berry, still getting a half jersey. I mean, they were finished 2 or 3 years ago. And then, as you said in your programme earlier on the day, that St Johnston are away and going to buy Billy Dodds. And surely Hearts could...
What would your solution be then?
Eh?
What's your solution? What would you like to see happen?
I'd like to see a couple of players bought like Ken for a start, and the likes of Kev Thomas getting more of a chance.
Right. And Davey, what do you feel about that?
The media's at Fashion and Johnson are getting every week, and according to our stories, there's a lot of bother in the dressing room or the head of that.
Okay, clearly they're not totally happy about things. Davey, what do you reckon they should do?
John, I honestly think that 7-8 months for a manager is certainly not long enough to give the guy. You've only got to look maybe 8-9 months ago to my former manager, Tommy McLean, who was receiving stick from all over the place. There was people outside the stadium wanting his head. And the chairman and the board at that time at Motherwell decided he was the man for the job. And look at the way he's turned that club round. I think to put a guy in a job like that and give him 7-8 months and then say you don't have any money to buy players so he can't bring in his own personnel, it's a very, very hard job for him to do, and I know it's frustrating for every Hearts fan, but really I honestly think, like Scott Crabelli, he should be given a bit longer to prove himself in the job.
OK, thanks for your calls and keep them coming. We'll be back with more in just a few minutes. Back to Jim.
Yeah, more to come from the panel in the last part of ScotSport coming up after the break. It's Aberdeen against St Johnston.
Super holiday must be won every day in this week's Daily Record. Guess the star and you could be flying off to summer sunshine with Direct Holidays. Plus, three big names are joining the record. Radio 1 Scots DJ Jackie Brambles with the latest gossip from America, Katie Wood with the lowdown on summer holidays, and turn your home into a palace with Fiona Holmes. All in your Super Daily Record. Don't miss it.
When I told them that Draft Tenants 80 now comes in a can, my mum and dad in Jalalabad got a new fridge in. Hence the carrier pigeon. New Draft Tenants 80 in a can. Too handy for words.
You're not on the scrounge again.
Look, I just want a bottle of your energizers.
You're having a laugh. You know it took me ages to get them back the last time.
Oh, go on.
I know they last longer than ordinary SP batches, but I do want them back.
I know.
Can I finish, mate?
No, you don't have to go on.
I can afford to go on. I've got Energizer batteries.
Energizer. Longer, 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 longer lasting batteries.
Ultra Lenore has an exciting new freshness. Tropical fresh. An exotic, gentle freshness. Mm. It's a breath of tropical fresh air for your wash from Ultra Lenore.
Working hard to make you happy from beginning to end.
Bang! Hans Ketchup!
Yee-haw!
I like to pour it on my grub because it's got the taste I love.
On bacon and eggs.
On bangers and mash.
And chicken and chips.
And burgers and beans and pies and peas and bacon and chips.
Yee-haw! With five different spices, it's the taste that's passing test. But if you're waiting, just don't hold your breath, get it on.
Nissan, the Series 2 Primera with ABS, as standard. Nasty car.